Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this this particular session, which is the fourth in the series of Coffee with the Bar. Initially speaking about the title itself, a lot of people have laughed at the title, a lot of people have been very angry with the title, a lot of people have expressed a lot of curiosity about the title. And which is why I wanted to give you probably a minute's explanation about this. This interaction is an informal interaction between effectively the judiciary and the bar, the bench and the bar. And since it is at 5 o'clock in the evening, the session of ours is at 5 o'clock in the evening, we thought we would call it Coffee with the Bar. If the session were at 7 o'clock in the evening, and that too today being a Friday, it would be coffee at the bar. It would not be coffee with the bar. So this is just an informal session, which is not to say that the basic levels of courtesy, both visual and verbal, should not be maintained. So we thank everybody for visiting, and we're trying this slightly different concept of having a one-on-one which is followed by a question answer session at a subsequent point of time. And we're trying this in a very different way. So we hope that you enjoy it as much as we have done preparing for the event. And of course, the speaker or the participant, so to say, for the session is Justice P.T. Asha. We welcome her. And Justice Asha, of course, we're not going by the typical lawyer's introduction, saying your lordship was born in so-and-so, your lordship had practice under so-and-so. It's just saying that you enrolled in 1989 and after that is what the subject matter of this session is all about for a few years. Now, after you enrolled in 1989, you were, of course, taken around the courts, be it the city civil courts, the high courts, etc. I mean, how was it? Because with most people, getting into courts as a junior, number one, you don't know the directions. Number two, you lose your way inside the courts. And number three, every court looks the same because it is red color and there are people in black and white sitting inside. So as a junior, what was your first impression about all these things? Justice Asha.
Good evening to everyone. I'm a little disappointed, despite it being a coffee with the bar, Shriram has not even supplied me with a virtual coffee. Anyway. Be that it may. The question, yes. In fact, I had the good fortune of having first joined the offices of Justice V. Ramasubramani. I was his first junior. So the first step that he did, am I audible, Sriram? Can you hear me?
Yes, you're audible to me. Yeah.
Yes. So, you know, the first day, what he did was he took me through all the court halls, both in the city civil court and the high court. In fact, the building itself was very intimidating. And when he was taking me around, I was wondering, why is he taking me around the buildings? But later, the whole thing unfolded that it took me a week to really understand where which court was. So therefore, my first introduction to the courts, both the city civil court as well as the high court, was a tour of the buildings. And of course, nowadays, if you take a junior for this tour, they are going to laugh at us because most of them have already seen the building as interns they've joined in. So they would laugh at us. But the days when we enrolled as a lawyer, we did not have this internship. We had all moved from the red building across into the red building here. So that was how I started my thing in the courts.
Ah, okay. Now, 2 decades or maybe 3 decades ago, section work was an integral part of a junior's initial work. Were you also, I'm not going into the details of what work you did in the sections, but were you also taken around the sections?
Yes. In fact, why do you say 3 decades ago? Even today, I feel going into the registry is a very important part of a lawyer's profession. If you do not know where you're going to file and how your paper comes out before the judge, I think that's a wrong way of learning the profession, getting into the...
So straight away, we come to a slightly contentious issue about present day juniors. So once you're there, you're going to be asked only politically incorrect questions. So this going to the section...
So you're asking me to be politically incorrect.
Obviously, because there are only juniors here. Going yes, to the sections, okay. Meeting the appeal examiners, making corrections, putting whitener, moving cases, going around with your clerks, the TNP sections, the CCC sections. Do you really think that present-day juniors are aware of all this?
I don't think so. Many of them are not, unfortunately. Many of them are not aware of it. This has been my experience sitting both in the appellate side and for a short while in the original side. And I also see that there is a marked reluctance on the side of the, on the part of the, some of the juniors to go to the section. They do not know where things are filed. Many of them, some of them, at least I should say.
Okay. So at that point of time that you enrolled and became a junior and started attending courts, you were effectively part of an office that was dealing predominantly in appellate side work, is it not? And therefore,
right.
Your interaction yeah. with clients per se was very, very minimal, except for people who would come to prepare CRPs or second appeals or to sign effectively. Your interaction in respect of facts with clients was very, very minimal. Is it not?
Yes, we mostly had the lower court advocates who would come over and instruct us, or mostly the briefs used to be sent by post at those times, yes.
Okay, which brings us to our first...
So therefore, the...
I'm sorry. Please.
So therefore, the interaction with the clients is not as much as an original side lawyer. You're not able to hear me?
No, I am. I am.
Are you not able to hear me?
I can.
As
I
much can. As an original side lawyer would, yes. Where an original side lawyer has to definitely interact with his clients.
Okay, which brings us to the first effective topic. When did your interaction with clients really start? See, according to me, there are two types of interactions. One is interaction by trial lawyers, where they prepare pleadings, petitions, etc. The other is interaction by appellate side lawyers, not taking a dig at anybody, but interaction by appellate side lawyers in respect of getting instructions, with instructions being within inverted commas. So when did this start for you,
yes.
your real interaction with lawyers?
You would be surprised. I was lucky in joining the firm in which I ultimately became a partner. See, the interaction, Mr. Sarvabhouman, my senior, Mr. Bhouman, I remember. Sarvabhouman, sir, the second day after I joined, initially I had joined Justice Ramasubramanian. Justice Ramasubramanian is the one who put me into this office, Sarvabhouman Associates. So it was the very next day after I joined the office, Sarvabhouman sir had asked me to take instructions from a client who had come in the morning. And he said, you take instructions, note down the instructions, and thereafter instruct your seniors who was either give instructions to Krishnan or to Patsarthi. So I could say that the day after I joined that office, I interacted, which was about 2 months when I was into the practice. 2 months into practice, yes, was my first interaction.
Okay. Okay, I see that you neatly avoided that question or that suggestion about appellate side lawyers getting instruction.
No, I'll come to that. No, okay. I'm not avoiding any questions.
Okay.
Yes, it makes a difference. See, for a trial lawyer, the trial lawyer is the foundation. Unless and until he gets the proper instructions from his client, he will not be able to draft the pleadings. And mind you, it is this pleading that takes the client right up to the Supreme Court. So unless the foundation is strong, you know, it's going to be a very weak edifice that you're going to build up. So therefore, the instructions that a trial lawyer takes in is totally different from the appellate side, because once you come to the appellate side, it's basically a postmortem of what happened, of what the trial lawyer is actually put in. So as a trial lawyer, you have to definitely take down notes, understand what your client is really trying to tell you, and also read between the lines. He might miss out on something, or he might deliberately burk some information. It is for you as a discerning lawyer to find out that missing link and try to bring it in. So interaction of a trial lawyer with a client is much more than what an appellate side lawyer would have.
Okay, in this context, how important is interaction with a client for a junior? Let's say a junior of 1 year old at the 1 year experience at the bar, 2 years at the bar. How important now, is that? No, I'm asking with specific reference to be it taking down of facts or dates and events, communication with the client.
No, I want a clarification there. Now, are you talking about juniors who are in some office, or are you talking about those juniors who have straight away become seniors?
No, in this, effectively, I'm the only person who's allowed to ask questions, not vice versa.
And no, I want a clarification. My answer would depend on the clarification.
No, we're basically talking about a junior who's in an office who has been given the opportunity of interacting with clients. How important is that?
It is very, very important that a junior should interact with the client, understand the case. He or she will get first-hand information about a client's case from the horse's mouth, as you would say. See, and while interacting with the client, it is very essential that a junior takes down notes. Very, very important. He or she has to note down the points which the client is going to put. And out of that, he'll have to sift what is necessary for his pleadings or his legal notice, whatever is the stage which normally it starts with a legal notice. So a legal notice, he has to get the necessary details. So therefore, interaction with the clients is very, very important. If you are not directly interacting with the client and it is your senior who is interacting with the client, the junior should definitely be present. In fact, when you start off, it would be better that you watch how your senior would interact with the client. What is the questions that would be asked? What is important? What should be ignored, what should be put in? All these are things that you learn when you sit there and work with your senior. I think most offices, the traditional offices, our office had that system. We used to always have a junior sitting when a client comes so that the junior would also be present when the instructions are being taken. And it would be that junior who would follow up the case later. So this was a pattern that was followed.
Okay. As a natural consequence of interacting with clients, depending on age and seniority in the office, of course, you start off with maybe notices, then money suit plaints, and then regular plaints, written statements, petitions, counters. So in other words, pleadings. Going by the present trend, of everything being available online in the form of templates even, how important do you think is this the ability to draft by using your mind and applying the relevant facts and the provisions of the law? How important is the ability to draft for a junior?
Original thinking is very important. Cut paste copy is not a culture that the junior should follow. See, when you write a plea, each case is different. The format may be the same. You have that in the CPC. But ultimately, the contents of the pleading has to be what your client has instructed you, and also based on whatever are the documents that the client puts across to you. So you cannot have a common pleading for every kind of suit.
True. So what you're saying is pleadings are very, very important.
Very
for
important.
Any junior starting off in this profession. So keeping this background in mind, what would be your suggestion or your advice for juniors, whether it would be to do trial work, which obviously includes drafting, or to do appellate side work, which is predominantly in the High Court? Not that district courts do not have appellate jurisdiction, they do. But predominantly, when you refer to appellate side work, you refer to the High Court. So what would be your advice or suggestion for juniors?
See, as far as Mofussil practice is concerned, they have to directly go to the trial court. I don't see the only advantage which I felt, since we moved from an appellate side, we had started off original side. The only advantage we felt was, as an appellate office, we knew what were the errors that were committed. So therefore, when we moved into the original side, it was a little bit more easier because we knew this would be a problematic pleading that we could take. So that did help us. But by and large, I don't think most juniors practicing outside Chennai would have the advantage of coming into appellate side work. But then if you're practicing in a district court, you do, I think, even trial lawyers in the offices, they practice both in the district munsif court and also in the district court and subordinate courts. So I think they're doing both appellate as well as trial work.
They do.
So therefore... But if you have an appellate side background, I feel to some extent that helps you when you draft, and also in the conduct of the case, that does help you because you know what it is, where the pitfalls of the case was. So when you are having a similar case, you will know, okay, in that case, I had made, this was the ground that was raised. So let us avoid this. Let us get the pleading the other way around. Basically, that helps you.
Okay. Now, going by your personal experience, as a junior, let's say for the first 5 years to 7 years of your professional career, what were the qualities that, according to you, helped you grow?
First point which I would say is my being in office on time every day. Every day. It used to be 8:30 on the dot. I used to be there in the office. So therefore, I feel, I do not know it. You should ask my seniors that, but I felt they could rely on me. They could see that, yes, this lady is there at 8:30 every day. So you can give her the work. And the second thing is, I never said no to any kind of work. I was ready to do any kind of work, be it clerical, be it carrying bundles, being whatever it was. We were ready to do that. Today, I feel that kind of a thing is a little lacking because many juniors feel that they should not go to the registry. The registry was another place. We used to work. Once we finish our work, we would go with our clerk. He was the one who taught us the registry work, starting when the filing, taking returns, complying with returns, taking us to the TMP section, like how you said, the triple C. Those days when order copies, we used to have these telegraphic orders and these carbon, all that, we did learn everything. And let me tell you, knowing the registry work is very, very important for any junior. If you are going to set up a separate practice, this is going to stand you in good stead. Tomorrow, when you set up practice and you have an advocate clerk, and you know what is the work, the clerk cannot take you for a ride because you will know where the problem is. And let me tell you, as a judge also, that has helped me.
Okay. Now, I told you most...
And another point you were asking me. And also your sincerity to work, your loyalty to the workplace, that is very, very important. There must be loyalty and sincerity in work. You just don't come think that this is only a place where you sit from 10 to 5 and go away. No. You are responsible. If you are entrusted a work, you must be able to see the end of that work. You cannot drop it midway and walk away because it's 5 o'clock, I have to go. That's not, I think those were some of the factors that helped me.
Okay. You have enumerated in broad terms the qualities that helped you grow. I can see that.
Helped all of us grow.
No, I can see that smile because you anticipate the slightly
politically incorrect statement.
Incorrect question. Next. The question has two limbs. Number one, compared to the times that you started your work as a professional, which is around 30 years ago, what qualities do you think are missing in juniors now? That's one part of it. That question cannot be answered without, you know, also answering the question as to what are the qualities you look forward to in a junior. And that second limb has A and B, 2A and 2B. 2A is, what qualities did you look forward to in a junior when you were the senior? And what qualities do you look forward to in a junior when you're a judge? I will tell you why. Because I'm sure the people who are on mute right now might not ask you the question, but I will ask you the question. When you're a junior, according to me, you give a hopeless case or a case in which your client has really remunerated you well, and you say it's a hopeless case, the law is against you, equity is against you, which accounts for 90% of our cases. You tell the junior, go to court, argue the matter, go hammer and tongs at the judge. Do not give in an inch. And I'm sorry. Okay. So
now I'll answer your second question.
No, I haven't even finished my questions.
Oh, you haven't? I thought
absolutely
you
not.
You're hammering?
Absolutely not. So when you're a senior, you send your junior to court on a hopeless case, both on facts and in the law, and you tell him, go hammer and tongs at the judge. Do not concede even one inch, and ensure that an order is passed on merits. We are coming to that elusive quality called fairness. Whereas as a judge, when somebody comes to defend the indefensible, don't you think, or don't you say, you should fairly concede? So what has been your expectation in that regard? Like the Americans do, you can take the fifth and refuse to answer that question.
No, I wouldn't refuse to answer the question because many of the juniors would be confused what they're supposed to do. See, first of all, I come from an office which first taught us fairness. If the case was bad, my seniors never told me that I should go hammer and tongs and try to somehow get an order. So therefore it is, when you are given a case as a raw junior, it is only to help you make your representations. It's all to test how good you are. Sometimes a bad case, if a junior goes, the judge might feel, okay, why not give him an admission? If
hold on. I'm not able to hear you.
Somebody is talking. Somebody is not muted themselves and they are speaking.
Hold on for a minute. Wilson, is somebody else trying to talk?
Sir, it's done, sir. All are muted.
All are muted. Yeah. Sorry about that.
Sorry for the interruption.
But Justice Asha is also muted.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Right.
I think Wilson didn't want the answer. Anyhow.
Wilson wouldn't have liked the answer about punctuality and timing.
Let us not embarrass the child here.
Yeah.
Right. So, therefore, when a junior is given a hopeless case, first of all, to answer you, we never gave a brief to the junior and said, you have to go there, hammer and tongs work. Because we never, even for a good case, we said, don't be too aggressive. You know, I remember the first instruction that Mr. Sarvabhouman gave when I was asking him, what is it that you would advise me, sir, as a lawyer? In fact, that's something which I remembered all and which I remember even now, which I use even now. He says, watch the judge read the brief in that order. If a judge is not agreeable to a particular point and has been showing reluctance to even hear you on that point, don't get aggressive on that point. Have a plan B in a place. Move to the next point. You can come back to the same point at a later point of time. Aggression, in my thing, it doesn't work well. So juniors should be a little, understated when they make the representation before court. It is not a moot court competition. You're before a live court. So that is something which is very, very, your body language, everything matters when you're making a representation before the court. Now, your first question, could you once again ask, just refresh the question?
No, that's the one about compared to around 30 years ago.
Right.
Or whenever.
Right.
Yeah.
See, in those days, most of us, we came from offices. In fact, a junior, from the style of representation itself, the judge will know from which office the junior came. The reason being that in those days, I remember after we finish our work, our seniors would tell us, go to this court, watch how the other persons are arguing the case. Please watch court proceedings. Today, what is it? Most courts, you have the youngster sitting in the last bench, chatting amongst themselves. Most of them are on their mobiles. Nobody cares to listen to a senior. If a senior is arguing, how many juniors take the interest to really watch the senior counsels argue? Or even there are so many mid-level juniors who are doing extremely well. How many of them watch the manner in which it is done? I'll give a small example. During one court vacation, there was one junior who came in and a very aggressive form of asking for an adjournment. You know, as if adjournment was a matter of right, the matter has to be adjourned. Adjournment was rightly refused by the bench. Come an experienced gentleman. You know, the way in which he had asked for an adjournment, but the manner in which the adjournment was asked, ultimately, the bench did concede to his request. See, these are all very important qualities that juniors have to imbibe. These are not taught in the books. Your law college doesn't teach you this. Your moot court competitions don't teach you this. These are taught to you live in courts. Every judge has a different body language. You must watch how that very same lawyer, you know, represents in the different courts. I'm sure you would agree with me, Sriram, in one court we would represent in one particular fashion. Come the next court, we would be in a totally different fashion, right? So therefore, these are all things that juniors have to necessarily learn, imbibe, and try to put it into practice. So therefore, today's juniors, you know, first thing, like how I said, timing happens to be a real problem. I find that most juniors straight away come to the court halls. I know that because when they come and may ask for an adjournment, I know they come without a bundle. They do not know what the matter is about. They've received a panic call from their senior asking them to make a representation because the senior is not able to appear. They are absolutely unaware of what they are. They only know senior unwell, want adjournment. But if this junior were to go to the office before the court starts, find out what the matters are of that day, take control of certain cases, at least one court, two courts, take control of the bundle, read the bundle, make a representation to the court, ask for an adjournment. But if the junior is able to tell the judge, yes, I've read the brief, but I can't do the matter, it is my senior who has to, every judge will accommodate them. There will be absolutely no problem because we have also come from this side of the bench. So we do understand the difficulties. The first problem with today's juniors is the question of timing. Second thing is, when we had all enrolled as juniors, money was never a question that we asked. I'm sorry, I'm saying this, but money was never, I agree, money, you do need to be remunerated, but money was not the be all and end all as far as we were concerned. The most important thing that we as juniors wanted is to learn work, to establish ourselves in the profession. Today, many juniors, the minute they enter the office, the first thing they ask is, how much will I get? And if the pay packet doesn't suit them, they're not ready. But they don't realize that in certain offices, they get to learn better. So that is the second point. Third point is the absolute reluctance of some to even step into the registry because they feel going to the registry is not their department. They are only lawyers. They are only here to argue cases. So therefore, it is only the clerk's duty to go to the registry. That is the third point which I feel today's juniors do lack.
Okay. So according to you, you would broadly say that punctuality, sincerity,
I missed out on one point.
Please.
If a brief is given to you by your senior and a senior gives you a work and asks you to do it, if you have not done it, come back honestly and say you have not done it. But don't give, excuses. And lead the senior along. Because it might, at some point of time, ricochet back on you. That's what I said. Sincerity is very, very, very important as punctuality is. You do your duty. Whatever is the work that is given to you, finish it. If you're unable to finish it, go back to your senior. Tell why you were not able to do it. Your senior will definitely find a solution to that.
Okay. So this sincerity would involve a bit of honesty, integrity, meticulousness in doing the case. Okay. Right. Now, how important is intelligence in all this? I'll tell you why. I'll give you a bit of background. Let's take the example of my own father. I'm not pointing fingers at anybody else. My father was a seriously good cricketer, and he was in the Ranji Probables, etc. in the early 60s. And he had to come to Law College, at which point of time Law College ground used to have senior division matches. So when he was going for lunch, the principal, who knew my grandfather, forced my father to come inside Law College, filled in his form, paid his fee for him, and that is how he started his journey as a junior. So in olden times, even around when I was studying in school, you first try for the first group,
medicine,
chartered accountant. Even a bank clerk was considered to be a very high post compared to a lowly lawyer. But the fact that this lawyers were on a very low pedestal was also confirmed by Citibank, because till around 1993-1994, taxi drivers, lawyers, etc. were categorized in one level and were not issued credit cards. Okay, so therefore, law was always the last resort. Ingala unak admission kadaikalena, eppadiyo law college la kadachirum. So how do you say that? That's the point that I was trying to make. Is intelligence really something that is very essential for success? Let's put it that way. For a
sound common sense, logical thinking, and then a bit of intelligence, yes.
I always say, when people come into my, if people have asked me for my opinion as to which is the quality that a lawyer should possess in abundance, and I've always said, for the medical field and for the legal field, it's curiosity that's the most important thing. The ability to question the establishment, adhukku adhiga prasangithanam irukkakoodathu, but the ability to question the establishment. Do you think that curiosity is
yes, but I feel as a lawyer you have to have a very logical thinking, you should have a sound common sense and a practical thinking. See, sometimes when a question is thrown to you all of a sudden by the bench, you must be able to have the ability to think on your feet. Sometimes the thinking may not correlate to the legal proposition that you know. So, you know, these are all, that is why I said, I would say, yes, you have to be intelligent. You should, intelligent meaning, if you mean the intelligence as in getting 90% in the thing, is that what you're trying to mean, or an average intelligence? Average intelligence would do.
I am definitely not talking about 90%. How can I ever talk about that?
Right. Average intelligence, sound common sense, logical thinking, and being very practical. These four ingredients, I think, is essential for a lawyer to go for. I'm talking from my experience also.
Okay. No, we did not doubt that. We did not doubt that. Okay. Now, there are a lot of things that will happen to a junior that will sometimes could break a junior. Things, incidents that will happen that will, you know, encourage him to put in his best. Have any such incidents happened to you in the first few years of your life that have changed the way you are either... you either look at the profession or the way you have been in the profession subsequently? Well, a lot of such things have happened to me. I'm just curious about what's happened.
No. Let me tell you, I was one who always wanted to be a lawyer. Being a lawyer was my passion. Way back in school days, the only thing I wanted to do was I wanted to become a lawyer. And being a woman, of course, that is what my father was very, very reluctant. In fact, he was downright against my becoming a lawyer. He says, "Pombala pillaiga lawyer, no way." But anyhow, I did manage to get in. Then the second stumbling block was becoming a lawyer. Joining the law college was the first stumbling block. The second stumbling block, as far as I was concerned, was becoming a lawyer. Once again, I promised my father that I'll give it 3 years. 3 years, if I'm not able to do anything, I'll come back. But I was very lucky that I got into an office like Sarvo Moon Associates, and I had a senior in, like Mr. Krishnan and the others. So I really started enjoying my work. I've not had any major hiccups as far as the profession is concerned, where I wanted to walk out of the profession. No. Every incident has only made me like the profession more and more. If you ask me incidents as a lawyer, I've had some interesting incidents. The first time I was asked to represent before Justice Nayanar Sundaram. And to some question that Justice Nayanar Sundaram had said, instead of saying, yes, I happen to use the word, yeah. Sriram, I'm not able to see you.
Really? Now?
Yes, now I'm. Okay. I happen to use the word, yeah. And I got a earful for that. That ended the use of the word, yeah. One. Second, I remember I was asked to go to a court. There was a CRP. And the instructions was that as far as the CMP was concerned, it was about a month when I joined the office. As far as the CMP interim orders was concerned, you leave it to the judge. So I'd read the papers. The minute the judge asked me, what do you say? I said, I leave it to your lordship. The CRP got allowed. It was not the CMP, the CRP itself got allowed. And the review, the later review also was dismissed. So from that day on, I stopped using the word, I leave it to your lordship. I started being very specific. As far as the interim orders are concerned, I leave it to your lordship. But when it comes to the main case, please hear me before you pass any orders. So this was the second lesson that I have learned. The third lesson is...
Sorry to interrupt. Purely in a lighter vein, no? I leave it to your lordship to pass whatever suit of orders. I know there are a lot of these chaps from the government who are part of this meeting, but is that why you never made the government side advocate?
I pass over the question.
Okay. Okay.
Right. Then the third incident, which really, yes, that was, I did not know Tamil, because I did Hindi in school. So, and being in an appellate side office, initially I found it very difficult because most of the judgments were in Tamil. I had come, all of you know Justice Ratnam's court I go. And what I used to do is my seniors would tell me what it is, I'll write it in English and go to the court. So then, you know, when you're up there, you know what's happening. Let me tell you, this is also a warning to all the juniors. When you sit up there, you have a 365 degree view. The judge knew that I'm just reading out from it. So he said, read that entire paragraph. And I was flummoxed. I couldn't do it. So I said, I'm sorry, my lord, I do not know Tamil. So he turned around and addressed the general court and said, are we not in the state of Tamil Nadu? You know, that really hit a chord in me. I decided then and there that I will read Tamil, I would learn Tamil. And today I can very confidently say that I can read it quite well. So this was a turning point as far as I was concerned, yes. Speaking for the better.
Of course. Speaking about Justice Ratnam, most anecdotes and incidents, we cannot even mention names, avarottare, innottare, another advocate, because all these people are still around. Some of them are judges. The best thing about Justice Ratnam that I heard from a very, very busy practitioner at that point of time was, after he had finished arguing, Justice Ratnam looked down at him from his lofty specs on the edge of his nose and said, have you got anything worthwhile to contribute to this case?
Yes.
You know the person to whom it was addressed. Okay, right. So, amazing sense of humor as well. It could be rather terrifying, but great sense of humor. Okay, right. So, now coming to the question of, now that we've spoken about intelligence, curiosity, punctuality, timing, etc. What about attitude? Because according to me, aggression will come inside attitude, aggression, probably tons of self-confidence. How important do you think is attitude? I mean, the way you, shall we say, present yourself in court. Wilson, mute everybody, Wilson. Wilson, I'm able to hear Gandhimathi's voice. I'm not in a tearing hurry to hear it too much. So why don't you mute her?
Sir, yes, sir, I've done it.
Okay, right. Sorry.
Yes.
So, how important do you think is attitude? And which brings me to that question that I wanted to ask when you brought about this question of aggression. Aggression as a whole, are you opposed to it? Are you saying that juniors should not be aggressive, or it should be within permissible limits? What is your opinion on that?
You can put across your point without shouting. Put across the point nicely. You know, to very great extent, you talked about self-confidence. Everyone requires self-confidence, but you should not have overconfidence. And when you are addressing the bench, see, you remember Justice Venkatasamy I'll tell you the difference between two judges. Justice Venkatasamy never liked juniors addressing the court from the last seat. They had to come in front. That was what was told to us. So we generally addressed him just, you know, in the first seat. Whereas Justice Raju disliked it when juniors came near the bench and argued. He would say, please go to the end. In fact, he tore me apart because on one day I happened to go near because there was too much of a crowd. So, you know, each judge has a different outlook to how a junior addresses the court. Now, since you're asking this specifically with relation to juniors, see, you can put across a point very nicely. You can put, like how I said, when you know you are having a losing battle with one particular point, don't keep on harping on that point. Come to the next point. Because, you know, when already the judge's mind is made up in one way with reference to that particular argument that you're putting forward, and you don't find favor with the judge in that, move to the next. Don't keep on harping on that point. And there's another issue also. Sometimes when a question is asked to a junior, the junior never answers that question. He keeps coming back to the same point. That is another attitude that juniors should, avoid. Too much of aggression, yes, it is. I would say it is a no-no. Aggression accompanied by the body language can be a put-off.
True. Talking about attitude, aggression and all that. Attitude. Between 1995 to 1997, all those who were present in the meeting, who practiced in the city civil courts, will remember Justice Akbar Ali and Justice Periyakarpaiah very fondly. Justice Akbar Ali was in the third assistant court and Justice Periyakarpaiah in the second assistant. Both of them were, juniors had a wonderful time appearing before them, and because they used to be very good, and they also used to be very nice towards juniors. They used to be nicer towards juniors, let me put it that way. At that same time, there was a gentleman called Pon Ram, who was the 17th assistant judge, who subsequently, I don't know, you might remember him. He died on Christmas Day in 1997 when he was in service. I think his daughter also became. So I remember when Ippon and the government leader or building irukala pudu building anga vandu there were a few on the gudra car parking and horse stables and all that. The 17th assistant or the 18th assistant court was there. I was a raw junior then, so ex parte evidence, at which point of time proof affidavits had not come into existence, so we had to take chief examination in an ex parte suit up. So evidence was over, and the judge Pon Ram wrote the evidence by hand, and he was making some notation in the bundle, at which point of time I had finished asking my client, which was an officer from Andhra Bank, saying that taava padi thirpu vaanganum nu ketukuren ama. That fellow did not even utter a word except for saying his father's name. So by the time my witness got down from the box, I had taken up my bundle in hand, suit decreed as prayed for with cost. I had written it. And then the judge looked at me. He said, 17-2 for arguments. I looked at him, he looked at me, and then I told him, ex parte evidence. He said, I know. I said, the defendants are not appearing. He said, I know. I said, it has to be decreed. He said, I'm not convinced about limitation. Come and argue that point. So, romba avasara pada vendam. The manner, the attitude of being impulsive is something that I realized to my bitter experience very early on. Apart from that, there have been, I don't know whether you remember this gentleman who used to come to the city civil courts called A. Shanmugavelu, who was the founder of Arepuram. Short man with, luckily he's no more, so I can say that, with hair like a porcupine. His wife was also a lawyer. So him, and then there was an incident with him, then there was an incident involving my dad and Mr. T.K. Seshadri. Then there was an incident in the small causes court involving Mr. K.P. Unnikrishnan and Mr. G.R.S. Chandar Rao. None of these incidents, I can say it out in public. None of them. But all these incidents had a tremendous impact on me, because it taught me in some cases what to do and in some cases what not to do as well. So it was incredible. So ultimately, the net takeaway from all these incidents was that attitude and discipline was very, very important. And when we're talking about discipline, we're also talking about discipline as far as dressing is concerned, the dress code. Okay, we will come to that a bit later.
No, in fact, from your statement, there is also a takeaway there. You came to know all this because you were sitting there and watching cases. So, you know, it was so by watching, you had also gained some knowledge. That is what I said juniors have to do. Go to the courts, watch how cases are conducted. They learn a lot from that.
Absolutely, absolutely. And so now that in the last 10 years, 15 years, we've come to the explosion of information being available. So with the advent of technology, computers, internet, research databases available, some people would argue that getting information on legal issues has become easier. As a junior, how was it for you? Did you have to sit till 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, pour through musty books after tying a handkerchief around your face?
No. Yes, during our times it was there. But I feel those times, I remember Mr. Krishnan, my senior, was very insistent. If you look up a law, you're analyzing a case law, you must always try to get the march of law. You go back, take out all the judgments, and then, you know, you compile the whole thing to come at your legal point, whatever you want to put across. Today, because it is all available in the internet, this kind of actually sitting there and working, sometimes I find is less. But of course, computers are here to stay. Definitely, it has reduced the work. You remember how we used to sit, the number of hours that you work, definitely, if you're able to read, if you're tech savvy, it helps you. I wouldn't completely say technology is no. It has definitely reduced the number of hours that you have to work on looking up case laws. But the thing is, you ask a junior, immediately it is just, you know, they just go and they key in the word. They do not know how to actually research. What is the thing that they use the words and they take out the judgments. So unlike in those times where we had to know what was the provision of law, under which act is it that I'm looking out the law? You know, that I feel to some extent is missing out here. And for an admission, yes, it might be very useful. Get in the latest law. For an admission, it will help you. But ultimately, for a final hearing, you had to be more prepared. So I can't really say no to technology. Neither can I. And the only thing which technology has caused, one problem it has caused, cut, paste, copy. So you will cut from some other affidavit, you would forget to remove, delete that, and you would find that in the other case where it is totally irrelevant. We have found case. We have, as a judge, I have found 2-3 matters where unnecessary paragraphs have been found, which is not relevant to the case. That is because it's a cut-paste copy affidavit. So the original thinking, yes, I come back to my original point. The original thinking is me. How many juniors today know to file to draft out an affidavit of adjournment? Affidavit of service? They do not know what it is. Appellate side, search memo. They start floundering around. So this original thinking has gone.
No, even if they know how to draft out a search memo, the moot question is,
they don't know where to file it?
Okay.
Very true. That is right. True. Yes.
Okay. Anyway, I will just read out one chat here. I'm not mentioning the person's name. One person is saying, we never seek for an adjournment, sir.
Good.
No.
So what you demand in it? Do you demand an adjournment?
I'm sure the person knows that I'm talking about his particular post. I have to verify whether he's really a lawyer if he doesn't seek an adjournment.
Correct. Right. Yeah. In fact, taking an adjournment, art of adjournment is, you need really, it's a real art.
Yeah, true. We have to come to that. So do you think that with technology and how it has helped the legal profession, with specific reference to juniors, the usage of a lot of case laws is good for both the juniors as well as for the court? What is your opinion? It is.
Definitely.
Okay.
Definitely. The research is really helping. In fact, I have some interns who are very good at that. So okay. They really come out with a very good search and thing. And another thing is, one good thing about this technology is, a junior, see, law juniors, they don't have that much of income. They don't have to invest on big libraries. You know how expensive it is to have a library, a full-fledged library is very expensive. So this Indian Kanon.
Yeah.
Right.
And you don't have to subscribe as well.
Exactly.
That's even more helpful. Okay.
In fact, it has quite a lot of judgments also.
Okay. So, just a take off on that. When do you think a junior should start doing cases? When we're talking about doing cases, we're talking about, let's say, either cross-examination or arguments. I'm not getting into arguing an appeal. Or when do you think? No, I'm not asking in terms of at the 2 years from the date of enrollment.
No. If they are confident and they are thorough with their facts, day one.
Great. And
but they must be thorough with their facts. They need not know the law. The court will take care of it, but they should be thorough with the facts.
It always used to be said of Justice Ratnam's court that you take care of the facts and he will take care.
He'll take care of them. Yeah. We all came up that way.
Mm. Yeah, true. Okay, so now let's move on to a bit of not flippant topics. Let's move on to a bit of miscellaneous ones. As far as juniors are concerned, nowadays, the enrollment, let's say enrollment is on 15th of May or 15th of November. They will give you an invitation saying we are having a get together after the enrollment on 15th of November. And they will give you another invitation, which is for the 13th of November. And if you ask them, what is this invitation? They will tell you, sir, I'm putting up an independent office 2 days before the enrollment. So how, you're a person who not grew up in an office. You joined an office and you contributed to the growth of the office in one way or the other. You were part of the growth of the office. And ultimately you made partner. You were partner for more than a decade. In that context, the Madras High Court especially has got a lot of examples. I'm not mentioning names of people who've been with their senior for 30 years, 35 years, 40 years. Whether that's good or not is a different thing. But how important do you think is continuity in a particular office for a junior?
See, first of all, the straightaway starting off independently is, see, every place, even in a private organization, you have something called a probation period. What we learn in the law college is not, we unlearn the whole thing when we step in as lawyers. You have to learn the ropes. How will you learn the ropes of the profession? You have to be a junior under a senior. At least for 2-3, in fact, I would say for 3-4 years, you definitely have to be a junior to learn something. Unless you learn, and it is, and being a lawyer is not only going to the court and arguing the case. There's so many things that makes a lawyer. All this you will be able to know only if you join an office, intern, I mean, work under a senior, and then you can confidently set up your own practice. Continuity does help a lot. I'll tell you, continuity not only from the point of view of the junior. Clients, in fact, while I was a lawyer, I've had several of my clients coming back and telling me, we like your office because when we come back, we see the same juniors there. So we have a kind of a confidence in the office. So continuity in an office is not only good for a junior, it is also good when you look at it from a point of view of a client. Now, yes, if you are not comfortable with an office, it is not, I mean, it would be in your own interest to move out. But any junior, in my opinion, I would suggest that they join some firm, learn the working, and then move out. Okay. You can't be a Swayambhu.
There are maybe. Okay. Now, coming to the art of representing in court, whether it is for an adjournment or whether it is for a Passover or whether it is to make it sound as though you're ready to get on with the matter, but what in reality you need is an adjournment. I have been a personal witness for the one and only V.S. Subramaniam, Tarpan Subramaniam. If he was not ready with a matter, he would come in the old time anecdotes, bringing 10 books and bamboozling or
threatening. Mr. G. Subramaniam, you're missing out on Mr. G. Subramaniam.
Yes, sir. Our P.B. Balaji was instructing him with that Sri Vidya actress matter. 25 books if he didn't want to do the matter. Oh, he was brilliant. P.S. Subramaniam, his art of asking for an adjournment was such that the judge would feel like, you know, getting down and saying, V.S.S. Tappa Nanchikadhiya, Na Ungalukku Kandipa Vaayda Kuduthurren. V.S.S. used to say, I have no objection if your lordship adjourns the matter. The exact words.
So, but he had the stature to say that.
He did. He had the stature to say that. And physically also he had the stature to say that with a 18 or 24 inches of turban over his height. Okay. So this art of representing in court, I'm asking you purely from the point of view of a judge. So you have been seeing this for the past, since when you were elevated. Do you think that the art of advocacy is there in how people represent in court? I'm asking specifically with reference to juniors.
Juniors think that getting an adjournment is a matter of right today. So therefore, there's no thought that is given when asking for an adjournment. In fact, I have noticed some juniors get irritated when I say that I'm not going to grant you the adjournment. It's actually sad because they don't realize when we started in the profession, the first thing we have thought is even when you're going to ask an adjournment, read the bundle and then go. If the judge asks you some question, answer that. That's what I said in the first thing itself, that, you know, if a junior comes and I know that the junior knows the facts, but The junior cannot get on with the matter. Any court, any judge would grant the adjournment. Possibly I might say, no, you come back tomorrow, you come and do the matter. If I know that it. Nowadays, the question is, Lordship, have the matter on Tuesday. Lordship, have the matter on Wednesday. I have juniors coming and ask, exactly, this is the representation that is made. And when a judge reads the brief, comes to the court, and this is the kind of thing, it can just definitely be a put off. So taking an adjournment is also an art which youngsters have to know. They cannot think that it's a matter of right. Passovers and adjournments are not a matter of right.
Okay. Now, the next thing is humor in court. I shouldn't be somebody who's asking you questions about this, but do you think that the humor still subsists in court? I'm asking for your honest opinion.
Yes, in some courts it does exist. But yes, by and large, the humor is... so long as you don't make a joker of the judge.
But you have to remember one thing. Humor is always a two-way street. So you have to be prepared for some comments aimed at yourself as well. So where do you draw a line? I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know me. I don't draw lines at all.
See, correct. So long as it doesn't lower the dignity of the chair that I'm sitting in, then yes, there can be humor. But the minute it is not the person sitting there, it is the chair that I sit on that gives me the position. So anything which lowers the dignity of the chair, yes, that is not possible. But a mild joke in court. I'm sure you know I do joke in courts. You are the recipient of it.
We do.
Yes. So therefore, a bit of that is, it also kind of, you know, relaxes even the judge. At least I relax. I can speak only for myself. I can't speak for my brothers and sisters. But yes, it does relax the mood. See, a very, very tense case going on. In between that, if you're going to joke while, you know, tempers are running, nerves are frayed, at that point of time, a flippant statement is come, it is not appreciated. But possibly after that, if some... a mild joke is thing. Yes, it's welcome.
So,
like how I said, so long as the judge has not made the joke up.
So, as long as the judge and the other side do not take it amiss, it's okay?
It's okay. In my court, it's okay.
Okay. No, we're not holding you to that statement. To use it in other courts and said, Justice
That's
Asha
what I
said it.
I'm only answering for myself. This question is only answering. I remember Justice Parthiban had, Mr. Vijayaraghavan in one of his musings had quoted that and said that Justice Parthiban had made a statement that humor is missing in courts. So that is on print.
No, like I told you, I think humor is also missing in the High Court Museum. We have to ask Thakur Krishnamurti about it. Okay. Now, coming to this vexed question of COVID-19 and the coronavirus. So, this has introduced social distancing. But are you aware that social distancing has not been brought about by either the Prime Minister of India or the President of the United States or by the WHO or anybody? As far as India is concerned, it's been brought in by the judiciary. I hope you know that. There is something called the Bangalore Principles of Judicial Conduct 2002, where a confederation of chief justices all over reduced their deliberations to writing, in which one of the points that has been debated and minuted as an accepted thing for judicial officers is judicial aloofness, and that judicial aloofness has been described by Justice R.V. Ravindran as maintaining a distance.
I think that aloofness is not what is the social distancing that is.
No. I understand that. My English is not so bad. Okay, what I was coming to say is, that aloofness is obviously different, that distancing. But what I'm coming to say is, this interaction between you on one hand and around 100 lawyers on another hand, it's in public domain. And this Bangalore principles, 2002 principles, have been followed by every state judiciary for training for its district subordinate judiciary, whether it's Rajasthan or Tamil Nadu, the rules include that. Do you think that it is time for there to be a closer relationship between the bench and the bar? We will take it as your personal opinion. Let's not ruffle any feathers there.
No. See, to some extent, we are forced to maintain a distance. Some people take advantage of the closeness that they would have had with us at one point of time.
No, me too, because I'm taking a screenshot of this and sending it on all my groups.
Exactly. I just coming to Justice Kapoor's comments that he has made.
Yeah.
See, so therefore, we are a vulnerable lot now. We are living in a glass house. So therefore, initially, for example, I used to entertain juniors. I used to entertain advocates into my chamber. Now I don't.
Oh, really?
No mentionings are permitted in the chambers. So, you know, sometimes you're forced to do certain things because of certain incidences. That's all. I don't want to comment more than that.
Okay, fair enough. Now, this question of video conferencing, cases by video conferencing, do you envisage some permanency to this? Because after all, it seems to be a nice thing, provided everything is digitalized and the infrastructure needs to be in place. If the infrastructure is in place, I'll tell you why. Yesterday, I moved a writ petition for release of 250 tons of food items before Justice Parthiban, and he was listening to me and interacting with me on video conference purely based on his memory, because he did not have either the PDF file or a physical copy, because there was nobody with him. So do you envisage this doing cases by video conferencing to have some element of permanency? Would you be in favor of that?
Let me say that I'm still not tech savvy, so I'm not very comfortable with that. You told me that I'm the one asking the questions, so you can't ask a question. I'm asking a question now.
Yeah.
How would you enjoy cross-examining a witness by video conference?
I would hate it.
That's the answer. I would also. So therefore, it is going to take time. See, interacting, you know, directly looking at the judge and interacting with the judge, or the judge interacting with the. See, this way, one to one, it is okay. But in a writ petition and other things, it is okay. But trial side, I do not know. I do not know how effective.
With reference to the demeanor of the witness.
Exactly. Demeanor of the witness. Demeanor of advocates also.
Are they happy if nobody looks at us? which is why the proposals to introduce CCTV camera in the family court has been stoutly opposed.
No, it's not. Yes, to some extent, it'll be a lot of fun for the others.
Absolutely. So now, coming back to this very, very light topic about the dress code. Let's first go by what I had to mention. You would have, of course, read about the two incidents in the Rajasthan High Court where, in video conferencing, the people came out in a banyan or vest or something like that. It's it's not really the first time it's happening, because in Florida, there was, I think it was Judge Bailey or something. There was a male lawyer who came shirtless, and he's recorded it. And there was a lady lawyer who was in bed, still under the bed sheets, and he's recorded it. The only thing Judge Bailey has not recorded, to my great disappointment, is whether it was in the same video. That he's not recorded. That's one. Number two, in Brazil, there was this judge who came bare-chested having a drink. But of course, his defense was that he was not aware that the camera was on. And there was this French-Israeli lawyer in France who posed naked on a motorbike, though it was not promoting himself as a lawyer. And there was this lawyer called Burns in Florida who came to court on a stretcher in his pajamas because he wanted an adjournment. And in our own country, in Allahabad, I think it was a reported judgment in 1974, Allahabad, a lawyer came with a plea to permit him to appear in dhoti and kurta, which was refused. AR 1974, Allahabad. And I believe the page number is 133. So keeping all this in mind, we of course, which is why we have, I hope you've noted that we've shut out the video for all these fellows, all the participants today, not that they will be indecent, we've shut out the videos for all of them. And but what is your personal opinion about the dress code in court? Okay, that's point number one. Point number two, do you think that we have to be very formal, both in terms of dressing and how you appear? Well, there's a distinction in that. What are your thoughts about that?
See, they say, all party, all party. See, you have to be definitely groomed well when you appear. You're a professional, so therefore when you appear before court, it not only court, even in your office when you're meeting clients, you know, if you come in an unkempt, you know, some of them come with this jeans, and nowadays the jeans, you're so worried it will fall off, you know, that kind of attire, you come unshaven, you know, unkempt hair, you know, it puts off the person. You know, the impression you give to a client or to the bench is that you are a very casual person. You know, you do not give out that seriousness with which you have come to represent your case. And it does kind of, you know, to a very great extent, put off the person on the other side. You come well groomed, you get a second look, and you know you're taken seriously. See, you have people coming with anklets, walking across in a silent court hall when you have the anklets. In fact, if you notice in my court hall, my staff will not wear, even my staff don't wear anklets. They wear anklets without bell. See, because these are all things that affect the decorum of the court. The dignity of the court has to be maintained. See, in school, we have all been in uniforms. You have a uniform, you have a prescribed uniform, both for the men as well as the women. Stick to that. When you come well-groomed, formally dressed, you were taken seriously. That's, I feel that is a very important thing as far as you.
Okay.
When you appear before court.
Fair enough. It's a solemn place. Exactly. You can have a bit of humor in it, but that's a different thing. That's a different thing. Solemn place requires a certain attire.
Exactly.
But having said that, your statement about the staff in your court not wearing anklets, purely in a lighter vein, we've not reached that stage where we've started looking at the staff.
No, I am making a statement for others to understand.
Okay. Right. Okay.
I'm
No, no, I'm sure most of your thoughts and most of my thoughts we can never express in public.
Exactly.
I'm sure. And so that's it, Justice B.T. Asha, thank you very much.
And any questions?
I know that you don't like juniors in your court looking at the clock as well.
In fact, I'm not a junior. When you enter the office, don't look at the clock.
Yeah.
Are we taking questions from?
Yeah. Thank you very much. If Wilson, let me just see the few questions that I have got. If those people are here, you unmute them. They can ask the question. Joseph of Chennai Law Associates, are you here, Joseph?
Oh my God. Yes, sir. He's here. Can I unmute?
Joseph.
Hello, sir.
Hello, Sriram and my lord, I'm here.
Hi, Joseph. I can't see you.
Yeah, video is cut down, off screen.
No, we are happy, but why?
No, I thought it was at your end.
Yes, I can see you, Joseph.
No, we can see you.
I thought it was a junior's program.
Hey.
Joseph,
I am a junior compared to all sitting here.
Joseph, I think the lockdown has been in force for a very long time. You suddenly seem to have become older.
No.
Is it? Okay, right. Please.
I just wanted to ask my lord this question of lawyers setting up offices prior to enrollment. What Sriram had asked, without sufficient training on the clerical side or having any background of legal procedures in any established office, they rush to put their own office to the embarrassment of judges in the courts, to deny in fact justice to even needy clients. We get bad reviews from clients who are at the receiving end from such lawyers. So what exactly would be the time frame one should concentrate in the at least in the initial years of practice before deciding to opt of setting up an office?
That's what I said, a minimum of at least 3 years you have to be a junior.
That's what I was
train under a senior, and that 3 years you have to give your full-fledged attention to the work.
That's it.
Yes.
Thank you, Joseph.
Thank you
for attending. Yeah. The next person.
Why don't you ask Junior Sriram? Juniors.
No, Joseph Junior. That's what he says.
Yes.
Okay. Ram Prasad, are you here? Ram Prasad. Ram Prasad, anyway, his question...
No, sir, he's not here.
Okay. His question is, what efforts should seniors take to motivate juniors to continue in the profession, considering the gestation period? Obviously, he comes from the point of view of income or the lack of income.
No. A senior will motivate if there is a reciprocal from the junior. I can find a question from Raghavachari. Yes.
Is Raghavachari here?
I don't think so.
Sir. I thought I saw a question from Raghavachari.
No, Raghavendran.
Raghavendran. No, sorry. I read this. Raghavachari. Yes.
Good evening, Lord.
So,
shall I ask the question?
Raghavendran, please feel free.
Good evening, Lordship.
Can I see Raghavendran?
Raghavendran, we'd like to see you.
Can I see Raghavendran?
Please turn on your video, sir.
Good evening, Lord. The problem is, I'm also not addressing to the dress code. That's the reason, Lord, why I also turned off the video.
Now you're in lockdown. So it's okay. Yes.
Lord, being a junior, I have a question, Lord. Sometimes, Lord, we are... Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you're audible.
Continue.
You're audible, but you're not visible.
Sorry, Lakshmi.
Yeah. Sorry, you ask the
Lordship, sometimes a senior assigns a work to a junior to perform a registry works such as clerical works. Sometimes that results in confirmation with registry. Sometimes a senior would have drafted the case for a week and researched it. After that, when at the time of filing, AE would say, no, this is wrong. Change the draft or this case will not apply, which will lead to confrontation with the registry or something less. Another instance where we have been running over behind the officials of registry for certain work for days together, but that work is not been which is not successful with that person. But sometimes another person comes again, it will be within an instance it would have done it within minutes, but which we cannot do. So we have an instance sometimes we would be insulted by the registry official itself. Something personal remarks may be made, but even all these times we have to be silent. We have to face our senior, we have to face the client, we have to face the registry, and also uphold. Sometimes we have to stand against for our dignity also. Such occasions happens, what does the union should do?
First of all, don't go with a confrontist attitude to the registry. I have never done that. I have even a week before my elevation gone to the registry. You don't have to have a confrontist. Now, if the registry has put a return, first you get the return, represent the return. See, most of the advocates I find nowadays are not ready to take a return and represent. Write down the return, whatever is the return that is made, you're not ready to write and say why the return is wrong. Now, if in spite of you all explaining to the registry does not listen to you, you can always go back to the judge who is the portfolio judge and say that this is what has happened. And you can get ahead. Now, if suppose your case is not looked into and another person's case is looked into, you can definitely bring it to the attention of the SAR concerned and say this is what is happening. I mean, his higher up. If all doesn't work, you can ultimately go to the judge and say that this is what is happening. See, every time when you enter the registry, you should not go in thinking that you have to pick up a fight with the appeal examiner. Please understand, the appeal examiner is also under a lot of strain. It is not only your case that the appeal examiner is looking into. There are other matters also. Some which would have a motion slip which should have come. So the motion slip always takes priority over the rest. So, you know, I can assure you that if you are going to be, you know, if you're ready to accommodate, if you're ready to tell the registry, yes, okay, now I understand you're having a problem, I'll come back. But please, at that point of time, look into the matter. I'm sure you will be able to get the work done. See, you don't go in and say, the first statement you made is the senior makes you work like a clerk. I'm sorry, I have to make a small correction there.
What I meant is clerical work.
No, clerical work. It is not only clerical work, it is part of your work. Suppose you did not have a clerk and you were a single man industry, what would happen? You would be the one who would be doing the filing, the stitching. We have done that. You stitch, you file it, and everything is there. It is not. The clerical work is also part of an advocate's work. So therefore, you should not go in there with that mindset. Try it. Just change your attitude. Possibly you could. It would help you. You have a further problem, tell your senior. Call your senior and say, sir, this is what they are saying. What do I do? I'm sure today you all are all on mobile. We didn't have that advantage. We had a problem. We had to go all the way to the chamber. Of course, we had the chamber within the court complex itself. So try it out. That is my suggestion. That is my suggestion out of my personal experience.
It's a wonderful suggestion, my lord. Those advice we are waiting. Actually, we are doing clerical works, and sometimes there was a place where there exists confrontation. So there, what would a junior would do? What would
Raghavendran chanda podnonnu poninganna
prachni
neenga vandu anga pogumbodhu yes enakku innikku vandu enakku idu number aganum sir konjam panni kudunga appadi solradha sir na vakil enak panni kudunga solradhukku or vyathyasam.
Thank you lord.
Okay, thanks, yes. Raghavendran. The next question has come by email. Sometimes juniors, when they are on the receiving end from judges, are worried whether the judges would start, forming an impression, and not so good impression about them. And the juniors get scared to face the same judge again.
No, come again. Please repeat the question.
Sometimes the juniors in a particular office, when they are on the receiving end from a judge, are worried if the judge is not too favorably disposed towards them, and therefore they get scared to face the judge again on subsequent occasions. Despite the fact that it is a learning curve, they are worried and sometimes their confidence is destroyed. The question is that are judges forgiving if the juniors change their attitude?
Yes, definitely. We don't keep things in mind. The minute it's over, we forget it. But yes, if a junior makes a misrepresentation, tells a lie in court, yes, that goes in. Unfortunately, that gets in fixed F10 memory. It goes in.
Okay. Because I believe that person's 3-4 juniors are in this chat. That's why he's asking.
No. The thing is, just because a judge has pulled you up doesn't mean that you have to stop. You should change. Okay, the judge had made some comments. Try to change yourself and go back. The same judge will give you the order the next time. All these kind of things, none of us keep it in mind.
Okay, incidentally, the person who asked that question is Sri Charan Rangarajan.
Tell him he's not a junior.
Huh?
Tell him he's not a junior.
No, that is why he's a very, very, in Hindi cricket commentary, they say, very, very chaukanya fellow. That is why he said it is on behalf of the juniors.
No, I understand. In fact, see, these are all certain persons, when they argue, juniors can definitely watch. That's a compliment for Sri Charan.
Of course. Okay, the next person to ask a question is Venkatraman. Venkatraman, are you here?
Sir, Venkatraman, sir?
Venkatraman of, formerly of Rank Associates, are you here?
Venkatraman? Yes.
Mm. Venkatraman, I hope it's not a question relating to any case, future case, for which you issued a notice or something like that. Ilya?
Not at all, sir.
Okay, wonderful.
Not so good evening.
Yes, hey, let me see you.
I'm not.
No, Lordship, please pardon me for that because I'm not in.
No, okay, this is Nageswaran.
Lockdown.
Yes, tell me when you're
wrong. Lordship, my name may be in. In Mr. Sriram's term, he may probably say I'm not a junior, but in this crowd of seniors, I'm certainly a junior. But my question is about juniors who pass out of colleges like the National Law Schools and NALSA. We don't find them taking litigation as their career.
Mm.
So what is your advice, or my doubt was, how do you make them come to litigation? Because despite the aggressive and top class coaching and teaching that is given in the respective law schools, they don't seem to be taking litigation seriously, and what they generally prefer is what is known as a corporate practice, taking up jobs.
That's because litigation doesn't give them the remuneration they want.
What is your advice to them, Lordship? You can put it like to owe them to practice, to litigation.
No. See, that is actually a personal decision that each person takes. But I, for one, having studied the law, I would personally, I feel that litigation is the best place. I would always advise a junior to come in for litigation. But then you also have to look into their circumstances. Sometimes the junior might need the money. They may have some circumstances, we can't say that. So therefore, it is left to each individual. But my personal advice would be, come into litigation. provided you're able to get a good office. And you should also understand.
Great, Lodge, but my doubt.
No, when you come into litigation,
yes, Lodge.
You don't get a client the day you start litigation. Whereas if you join a corporate office, you know, every month your salary is assured. Unless and until litigation is made more remunerative, possibly they would come into that.
True. Great, Lodge. Thank you. Thank you, Lodge.
Thank you.
Okay. You are, of course, aware of Sai Prasad, originally in Ram Subramaniam Associates.
Mm.
Okay, Sai, are you here? Sai has texted something. He's put something on chat. It's not a question. I believe if he wore a slipper to office on a holiday.
Yeah, I am here.
Ah, Sai, you can express your thoughts directly.
Good evening, Your Lordship. I just wanted to express, when I was in Ram Subramaniam Associate, Mr. Sanjay Mohan, even if I wore a slipper to my office, even on a holiday, he would say, "Are you on vacation?" And if I had even a day's beard, he would say, "Are you not well? Or are you going to edana koyilukku poringla vendudala appadina?"
In fact, Mr. Gandhi,
I find that kind of a response today, I don't find with many of the juniors, as you rightly said, because most of them consider keeping an upkeep of their dresses in court as well as outside, they don't take it too seriously, including some of them I have seen even not even tucked in shirts.
Correct.
Unfortunate. Most unfortunate.
Yes.
Yeah,
I agree with you.
Yeah, I thought I can express my views. That's what.
Yes.
Thanks. Yes. Thanks.
Yes. Thank you. Yes, Sri.
Okay. Amog.
Good evening. Good evening, Asha.
Yeah.
Good evening.
Amog, switch on your video.
Yes, yes.
Good evening, Asha.
Good evening.
I request you to share your experience of arguing your first ever case, the preparations, the planning, and the nervousness surrounding those preparations. And secondly, your advice to the juniors about overcoming fear, inhibition, and nervousness.
Amog, we'll share everything with you. Why don't you share your entire face with us?
I know, just thinking, I'm increasing half of him.
Yeah.
So he's reading. He's noted down the question.
No, I know, but be a bit away from the camera. Ah, yeah.
Amog, in answer to your question, I was terrified. My first major representation, a CRP, which I was supposed to argue, was before Justice Nayanar Sundaram, which I earlier quoted, and where I made a where I said yeah to the question. But let me tell you, yes, I was terrified, and when he, ticked me off. And Justice Nayanar Sundaram never raised his voice, but you were being ticked off. But that didn't deter me from once again going to the court. Justice Ratnam's court, shivering. The paper, I couldn't hold on to the paper. The paper, I was a nervous wreck. Because 6'3", the man with that booming voice, absolutely terrified. But you have to overcome all this. You have decided that you are here to stay. You want to become a lawyer. You want to stay. These are all things that you have to personally overcome. Nothing, no judge is going to come and, terrorize you. We are here. The minute you know that a junior is prepared and is trying to make his or her representation, we are definitely ready to listen to them. We are definitely ready to give them that time. If you want further time, I've not prepared, I'll come back and I'll just pass it over. Ready to do that. We're ready to accommodate. So it all lies in your mindset. Don't give up.
you are here to become a lawyer, don't give up. You should have that never say die attitude in you. And I always say the junior should have a fire in the belly to come up, to come move up in the profession. That I find lacking in many juniors today. Yes.
Thank you.
Have I answered your question, Amok?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Okay, yeah. Amok, thank you. The next person who has a query.
Sreecharan Junior, one down.
Amok.
Sreecharan. Okay.
Yeah, he's a clever fellow. Once in three, four queries.
No, you... he has written down these questions and asked his juniors to ask.
100%. Handwriting kuda adhe da.
Chalas.
Okay. Next person is Prasanna Durai. Prasanna Durai, are you here?
Sir, he's not here, sir. He has some difficulty with connection, he said.
Oh, I see. No, no. His question was, what would be the minimum period to be a junior, which has already been answered? When should I open my own office? That's also already been answered. I've actually told him that we are going to accept Visa and MasterCard. So the advice for which we'll be charging him. Okay. So the next person is Savita Balasubramaniam, who seems to have a slightly interesting question. Savita Balasubramaniam.
Something good. I saw that National Law School. Ah, yes.
Ah, correct. Savita, are you here?
Yes.
Yes, sir. She's here.
Can we see you?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Why are you so reluctant, Savita?
I presume that you did not study in National Law School.
No. I was just trying to switch on my video.
No. I presume you did not study in National Law
School. Yeah, no. I did not study. And I've been practicing. No, I did not. You know, the children who are coming in from National Law School, they seem to be into more of research. You know, when a client comes to us, he comes for a solution. So, you know, they take a lot of time in drafting a case. Actually, they take a lot of time in researching the case. So, what is your comment about this, Mrs. Asha?
No, I didn't get you. You feel they are researching for a long time and not proceeding with the drafting?
Yeah, exactly. That is what I'm trying to say.
I guess the senior has to find out where the problem is and try to help the junior out. I think that's all. I can't give a one-stop solution for that. It's for the senior to... See, these are the times when the senior has to pay a bit of an attention on what is the problem with the junior and try to correct them.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So, is it only my view or... is it the same everywhere? Is it what? So that's my experience. That's what I want to
really wouldn't know that, Savita. Huh?
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Savita. The next person is Rukmini Venugopalan. Rukmini, are you here?
Yes, sir. Yes. Hello.
Rukmini has a slightly interesting question as well.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, Rukmini.
Good evening, Your Lordship.
Good evening.
Your Lordship, many of us actually took law as a matter of chance. So for me, law was a matter of chance. I just took law instead of BCom, and I'm pursuing a career right now. Many of my peers also are at crossroads right now because many of them they work a lot of hours, and the mental toll it takes on them, it makes them want to give up the profession at some point. It's not just the financial reason, but the fact that many of them are unable to perform as much as the others. And I have seen many people give up on the profession also. So I would just like to ask Your Lordship, what would be your advice to those people to keep them going? And what do you think would make any lawyer stand out in any court?
No. See, like how I said, you're asking the question to a wrong person, because according to me, once you are a lawyer, you know, you should forget to look at the clock.
Yes.
Because our profession is a 24/7 profession.
Yes.
Any minute. See, you take an advocate who practices on the criminal side. He's called at odd hours to come and help his client. So can he say that, no, I will not come? See, it is only during your initial stages, if you put in more number of hours of work, it will stand you in good stead as you become a senior in the profession.
Yes.
This initial, it is an investment that you're basically making.
Don't you invest in things? It is the same investment that you put in. You must be able to, 5 years, according to me, the first block is 5 years. If you are able to sustain yourself for 5 years in the profession, then yes, I feel you can go forward. Because the teething time, according to me, the gestation period, according to me, would be a minimum of 5 years when you are able to understand as to whether you really want to move forward in this profession or no, you throw your hands up and say that, no, I don't want to proceed further. It's a very, it is a wonderful profession as far as I'm concerned. I feel that a legal profession is a wonderful profession where you can do a lot. Once again, everything boils down to how much of passion you have in a work. Every work you have to be passionate. Even a sweeper has to be passionate about what they're doing, otherwise the work will not come out.
Yes, Yolaj. Hello?
Yes.
Yes.
You have that question to it.
No, Yolaj. I just wanted to tell for the record, I'm also a junior of Sri Charan Rangarajan. So, just wanted to
I'm
tell
going
that.
To pass an order of injunction restraining juniors of Sri Charan from asking questions.
No, I don't think we have to do all that. All we have to do is to pass an administrative order asking Wilson to mute them.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Lachu.
The next thing is from Sundaram Janathanan. The timings that a junior should spend in office.
If he is my junior, tell him he can ask the question.
Yes. I think he's yes.
Yes. Not a junior.
Yes. And the Janava, the short dark.
Adhe Janava. Enak theriyada.
Hey, Janava. Yes. Idella vandu juniors ku pa. Nee edhukku pa inga vara?
Lordship should say the timings the juniors should spend in the.
Illa. Illa. She can give the timings that a junior should come. And she can also give the timings that you used to come. I'm sure we don't want that.
No.
He was regular.
Jana is 1%. No. I have to say that Janardhanam was a very sincere, absolutely sincere junior. In fact, those were the days when I have to say that those were the days when we had this car. We didn't have the computer. So poor chap would write his counter and the counter would not come out well. I would tear it, make him rewrite the counter all over again. And
no. Because that is the experience as a junior we gain. Because today, as I am sitting as a lawyer after these days, after these 30 years, it's only because of M.S. Krishnan and P.T. Asha. Because she motivated me. Motivated. That motivation, because I speak today in English because Madam only. Because she used to ask me to read books, newspaper. That is only I developed. Because Nala on
the Jana, this is not a vote of thanks for me. This is a chat.
Everyone should learn. Juniors should learn. Tamil matto therinja matto juniors varamudi adandra idu kada. Juniors should learn. That is why I am. That's why I am coming and expressing my views.
சரி ஜனா
தேங்க்
யூ வெரி மச். அவங்க எழுதி கொடுத்ததுல வந்து இன்னும் எவ்வளவு பாக்கி இருக்கு சொல்றதுக்கு. தேங்க் யூ ஜனா, தேங்க் யூ வெரி மச். That was a personal touch.
Yes, I know.
It was. Thanks, ஜனா. The next person is Monica Chopra. Monica Chopra, are you here?
Monica?
I'm reminded of the song. Yes.
Ah.
Yes.
Yeah, this is Monica.
Good evening. Yes, Monica. Monica, you're in echo.
Your connection is. Your connection is.
Are you recording yourself?
No, my lord. I think it is because of the internet.
Yes, Monica. Otherwise, we have to sing out the song.
So, Mike.
Yes, tell me.
Sorry, is it
yes, audible? Yes, you're audible now. Yes, ask me. What is it that you want to know?
One second.
For my time in office being available 24/7, I want to know how can a young junior strike a balance between personal life as well as, career?
Are you asking it as a woman lawyer, or are you asking it as a lawyer per se?
As a lawyer per se.
Right. See, you have to prioritize your work. By being a lawyer or a senior is not going to say that you have to give up on your personal life.
Yes, sir.
But when you are in the office, there are timings as far as the office is concerned. If you have a personal life, say Sundays are off, or Friday evenings are off, Saturdays, whatever is the day you're off, you please have your whatever fun time or whatever it is with you. But during the office hours, during weekdays, I think you shouldn't think about a personal work if you want to become a lawyer, a successful lawyer.
Okay, Milo. And I also wanted to share a similar experience that I had on my first presentation before MSNJ. I also happened to utter yeah in front of him. And this went directly to my senior. I work with Mr. Hari Shankar from HSB Partners. So he got a call direct from the news. I didn't actually do that in the court. It's like I it just came out so spontaneously. I was very
No, all of us go through the same thing. That's what happened to me also.
Yes, Milo. Thank you so much.
So
yes.
You have a lot of hope, thank Monica. You. Don't worry.
Yeah, we'll get you a long way.
Thank
you. Okay. Yes, Jai Ganesha.
Seniors are asking questions, not juniors.
Jai Ganesha, are you here? Not here.
He's there, sir. He's there.
Ah, Jai Ganeshan.
I'm raining.
Ah.
Sir, please turn on your video.
Oh, video, Engappa. Where's your...
Sir.
Seniors are asking questions.
I think we are always juniors because it is a learning profession.
Oh-ho.
That's a very, very smart answer you've given. Yes. Okay.
No, my question was, nowadays the juniors, when they come after passing out, the first thing they ask is, what is the timing of the office? Mm-hmm. And should we come in the evening and all other things? So generally, we say that you should come in the evening also. They say it will be a little bit difficult. You can come directly in the morning. That is possible. So in those cases, what should we tell them?
Don't take that junior, simple.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you, Manu. Thank you.
Yes.
Shrishti Pandey, are you there?
I'll check, sir. Yeah. She's there, sir.
Shrishti Pandey.
Shrishti, on your video.
Yes, sir. Hi, sir. Yes, sir. I'm there, sir.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir, is it visible?
Yeah. You're audible as well.
Good evening.
Ma'am, I'm just studying. I'm a student in Shastra. Good evening, ma'am. I'm a student in Shastra, ma'am, and I just asked if as a student, I wish to practice in future. Would you suggest it is better for me to look for a vibrant internship? Or should I be more active in my mooting skills, like mooting in this 5 years of my course?
No, I was not able to catch your question fully. What is it?
I think she's trying to say which is more important, internships or more important is mooting, you know.
If you are going to litigate, I would say that your internships, you learn more, but I can't say even mooting, you learn how to make presentations. You make a fine balance between the two. Try to make a fine balance between the
two. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's just deep. Yes. Mute yourself.
Uma Maheshwari. Uma, are you there?
She's there, sir. Ma'am, yes.
Mine was not a question. Oh. Good evening, Your Lordship.
seniors are asking questions. Uma, hi, Uma.
No. I'm a junior to you, Your Lordship. I've seen you and come in this. Mine was not more of a question. It was on your, whatever you spoke on, the positivity of the attitude a junior should have. And our own office girl was inspired by you once when you helped her in the court hall. On the other day, on the power of women in judiciary, I heard you speak how the seniors should help juniors if they have a problem in the court hall, you see. And she spoke to me about you when you got elevated. Only then she knew that you are PT Asha. Otherwise, she was not aware of your name. So she said, this is an advocate who helped me the other day in City Civil Court, ma'am. I had an issue with, one of the seniors. And whatever you spoke today was really more very, very positive tone to the freshers and the advocates. You are just new in the bar.
Thank you, Uma.
Okay, and probably the last question for the evening. Into Priya Kamesh. Into Priya Kamesh. Are you there? Wilson, she's not there.
Wilson himself has gone running. There's one question from Ashok Kumar Ravichandran.
SM Ravichandran, sir.
Ask him to come live. Ask him to come live.
We have Indu.
Indu.
Is that Indu?
Yes.
Ashok, you will be the next one.
Yes, Indu.
My question is, this came from an interview from Rishi Kapoor's interview yesterday, ma'am, and where Abhinav Goswami had asked him about the nepotism in Bollywood, and he was very...
Into 1 minute, your voice is, you're not very audible. I mean, we're able to hear you, but you're not very audible.
Yes.
Yes, it's different.
You're not clear.
Okay, sir, can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's better.
Yes, yeah. Now it's better.
Ma'am, this is regarding nepotism in our profession. This came up because of yesterday's interview where Arnav Goswami was interviewing Rishi Kapoor, where Goswami had asked him about nepotism in Bollywood, and he was very furious with the host, and he was very angry, and he bashed Arnav Goswami. I hope you don't do that to me. Ma'am, my question is, what is your comment on nepotism, ma'am? Like, we have a lot of juniors who are first-generation lawyers, and in contrast distinction, we have a lot of other juniors who have been in the brush, who are fourth, fifth-generation lawyers. So, ma'am, to get the first case, or to, they have a lot of advantages in comparison to a lawyer who comes up for practicing first for the first generation. So, like many a times, it is sometimes very demotivating to see a first-generation lawyer, to struggle, because we have to struggle extra hard. We have to push ourselves beyond limits to achieve, to stay where we are. So what would be advice to a first-generation lawyer, ma'am, and how do we overcome this, if I could say, bias or partiality?
Yes. Good you asked this question, Indu, because this is... See, I'm a first-generation lawyer. I have come this far.
Yes.
Right? So therefore, you have a standing example right before you. And let me tell you one thing. Having a father or a grandfather or a brother or a sister in the profession will help you go to the first step of the ladder. After you reach the first step, you have to prove yourself. If you are not able to prove yourself, then you will not succeed. And a first-generation lawyer should never compare himself with the other lawyer. You have to prove your mettle by yourself. If you are going to work hard, see, I'll tell you, if you are going to start an office of yourself, you're going to sit in the office every day. Make it a point to come to the office at 8 o'clock. If you say 8 o'clock, you're in the office. Be in the office at 8 o'clock. 1 week, 2 week, 3 week, you might not have anybody coming and seeing you. The fourth week you might have somebody who will come and let me tell you, will come or notice kudukuringla. He might give you 100 rupees. But that is the first work. See, if you are able to show that you are sincere in your work, the work is going to come. And let me tell you, the legal profession is like an ocean with a lot of fish. There's a lot of, if you fish well, you catch the fish. You might catch small fish. The other person might catch a bigger fish. That's all the difference. So I don't think we should compare ourselves and say, see, it's more a case of you're being jealous of somebody. Let us take two first generation lawyers. One person might be exceptionally well. Now, can you say that I'm not able to succeed like him? You can't. So you have to prove yourself. Even a second generation lawyer has to prove himself. It is not an easy work. In fact, a second generation lawyer, especially if he happens to be the son or the brother or the nephew of a very senior and a very good lawyer, you know, the pressure is more on him to prove himself or herself. So don't be so demotivated.
Yes. No, ma'am, not demotivated. Definitely, like you are the standing example for us. I just wanted to ask, I wanted to know your take on this because you are an example to this. And so how did you, make your way up here? That's my question. And
I have no problems. Like how I started from the beginning, I had absolutely no problems. I was lucky I got into the office. They say the profession is 99% perspiration and 1% of luck. I was lucky also.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you much.
Yes, where's Ravichandran's son?
Yes,
Ashok,
come.
Ashok.
Good evening, ma'am. This is Ashok here. My question to you is, should a trial court practice made mandatory? Because when I was an amateur lawyer, I had a confusion whether to start in a trial set or an appellate side. So, till today, I have no exposure or I must say I have a minimal exposure in trial advocacy. So how much role a trial advocacy plays a part in appellate advocacy?
I didn't get your question at all, Ashok.
Shigam, what is the question?
Are you saying that
it is
do
important.
You definitely have to do trial court practice to become a good lawyer? Is that your question?
No, ma'am.
Yes,
how important?
Actually,
how important is it for a junior to have trial court experience? That's his exact.
To handle appellate cases, most important. He was specific about that. He also said to handle appeal cases. How important is
right.
Trial court case? How it helps in handling appeal cases in high court? I think that is his question.
Yes, is precisely that is my question. Yes, it's correct.
I really see. I went the reverse direction from appellate side to the trial court. I found it easier in the sense in drafting and other things. It was easier because you knew what was the shortcomings in a particular. So therefore. If you want to do appellate side practice, I don't think you have to really do a trial court practice to come to appellate side. Because both are a different style of function. And incidentally, your father does both trial work as well as appellate work. He's on the labor side, he's on the labor courts also he goes, right?
Correct. It is, but normally
right.
I had a confusion in choosing the INO practice. Should I actually go into conventional trial offices which does trials, or should I stick to the office which does appellate advocacy? So I'm still not.
Trial side practice is definitely quite interesting because that is where you really start your entire basis of the case is created there. So you are the people. In fact, it is the trial lawyer who is the most important peg in the. Entire wheel is what I would say. Trial court practice, yes, is important, but I wouldn't say that you have to first gain a trial court practice, a knowledge in trial court practice to succeed in an appellate side practice. No, I wouldn't. From my personal experience, I don't think so.
All right. Thank you so much.
Okay, and I think we've concluded right in time for dinner. So thank you, Justice Asha.
Thank you, Sheila.
From what I have seen, the honesty, the warmth with which you have treated the juniors and asked them and fielded their queries, doubts. You've been accommodative, you've been humorous, you've also been firm in your opinions. And even now, when you've been answering, you've always shown that you are looking out for the welfare of and for the benefit of the juniors, which effectively means you haven't changed. Thank you very much. We'll try our level
best. Thank you.
We'll try our level best to disturb you for many such things. And it was enjoyable. I enjoyed hosting you. I hope you enjoyed meeting all these wonderful senior and junior lawyers.
Thank you, Wilson. I have to give you a special thanks to Wilson. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.